You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And technically, this is the first time this person has been on the podcast, but I've already used technically wrong. Technically, they're returning, as they were an episode of the Sharp Dojo series way back in July 2021. I am joined by referee slash wrestler slash everything, does everything. Let's just get into it.
Very much.
It's Sean Moran. Welcome to the show. Welcome back.
Hello.
So, of course...
Well, it's great to be back, Billy.
I think we're slightly out of sync already.
3 years, man, so...
we're ever so slightly out of sync.
Fine, don't worry about it. just slightly out of sync, that's fine. Just but yeah, 3 years, you know, I think we've got plenty to talk about, so...
Absolutely.
Let's dive into it.
So we'll see how, hopefully everything kind of goes into sync at some point and we're not just talking over each other. But you're right, 3 years. Mm-hmm. 3 years has passed since our last chat. And at that point, you were kind of gearing up again to put the singlet back on. We're just coming back off, or just about to come back off, a long layoff due to the pandemic. And you were kind of, you'd had your time at Reckless and you're at the dojo. You're raring to go, and a couple of matches, and then that was the end of the in-ring road for Sean Moran for a moment. So we'll focus on the matches first, and then we'll talk about the big gap in between, because I think some important things, possibly non-wrestling related, took over a little bit, and I'll be able to sympathise and know what you're talking about. But yeah, that first match back, so I've got to note it down as Pro 2, as your first match back after the pandemic. With Bobby Roberts, the Anbang. Was that right? What was your kind of reaction to getting back in the ring at that point and after a pandemic and trying to ease yourself back in?
So I think the match with Bobby, if my timeline's right, it's either first or second, because I know him, I know Respect and Pro 2 had their first shows back relatively quite close to each other, so. I'll go and say like my first two matches in no particular order back were with Bobby Roberts in Pro 2 and then with Thomas Daniels in Respect. I imagine the answer I'll give you is the same that a lot of other of the guys that had that long layoff that I give you. While it was exciting to kind of get back and to get into some form of normality after, you know, lockdowns and all the kind of stuff that was there for the 18 months. You know, there was obviously a little bit of anxiety in the sense that even with like such a long layoff, like even with a little bit of training just beforehand, you know, where my initial thought was I still up at the same level that was pre-COVID? Because pre-COVID, you know, I was relatively busy when it came to my booking schedule. I think 2018, I was more or less booked on 2 or 3 shows a week, every week for that year. So obviously coming back from, you know, 18 to 24 months of not having that type of schedule or, you know, that type of experience, you know, you start to wonder if the ring rust is going to creep up, and then if you're going to be able to perform as well as you could have on the night. Thankfully, with those two matches, I feel like they couldn't have gone any better. Not in just in the sense of the in-ring work, but also just kind of feel like how both audiences reacted to them. Both matches are up on YouTube, and I watched them back fairly recently, just, you know, because I like to amuse myself watching my old stuff. And I was always happy with like the audience reaction to both of those matches, and you know, the kind of story that we told in both those matches. And yeah, you know, both Thomas and Daniel, Thomas and Daniel, sorry, both Thomas and Bobby were fun to work with, and you know, managed to help ease my nerves before the match, and then after the matches, you know, while we are our own worst critics, you know, I feel like I was satisfied with the stuff that we told in those matches.
It was a weird time. I mean, end of 2021, because the crowds, they were just, they were feral for wrestling, because, you know, it's probably the first time they were out to the house for 18 months, and they were getting to see it. And I know from going to shows myself, it was just electric. Like, just everyone was just amped that this live form of entertainment was back around. But it must have been a weird time for yourself. Like you said, the ring rust and the nerves, everything like that. But Scottish wrestling and UK wrestling in general was still quite kind of raw from all the things that happened, from companies shutting down, from people being dismissed from wrestling and all that kind of stuff. And did you feel that the locker room had changed because of all that? That it was a bit more, maybe a bit more open, a bit looser, or did you feel it was a bit more like I said, on that knife edge kind of thing of everyone kind of be more conscious to everyone else? Don't know if that would make sense.
Personally, I didn't feel that way. I like, don't get me wrong, there was a sort of air of change in the environment, because, and I think it still kind of has a ripple effect recently, where it's almost as a sense that there, you know, like you said, companies shutting down, certain people leaving for various reasons. There was kind of a sense that, you know, will it be the same? But there was also a sense of, you know, especially in the locker rooms that I have shared from then and now, there's a sense of basically you've got to rally each other up and, mm-hmm. you know, get the scene moving back forward. Myself, I've always been, always had this sort of optimistic sense when it comes to wrestling, where whether I'm doing whatever job I'm doing, I want to do the best I can, but I also want whatever show that I'm on to do the best that they can, and that's not changed at all. But I think post COVID there was almost sort of a rallying cry from a lot of locker rooms that, you know, we gotta provide for the paying audience and for the fans that have supported us throughout all this. Like, you know, with these factors, like 18 months without shows, COVID, just a lot of, like, shall we say, like, uneven discourse, not just in wrestling, but just in the world in general. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd say with that first show back at Respect, there was a big overwhelming feeling of let's give them their money's worth. I feel that was the more feeling that I got from the people that I shared the room with. And, you know, I would say for those first couple of shows back with Respect, Pro 2 and W3L, I feel that's, you know, what we provided them. That, you know, just the good old fashioned escapism that they paid money for.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, it you mentioned the ripple effect, and yeah, I think it's, I've found that myself, like when I'm trying to organize things, and it is still got that. But let's move on to some positive things. But I'm about to mention your last match before you took a extended hiatus. Mm-hmm. I've got to note it down as being Respect for Wrestling, Return of the Lord, against Looking Sharp in the UEWA European Cruiserweight Championship match. Did you know at this point this is probably going to be your final hurrah for a little while, or What was your feelings going into that one?
Well, just not to spoil anything, but I definitely didn't think it was going to be in the last match for a little bit. There were a lot of outside factors involved as to why it was like that for a bit, but I'll get into it. Basically, the match with Lou was built for a good couple of months just before we actually had that match. Obviously, myself and Lou have known each other at that time for about 7 years. And Lou's going to be very integral into my comeback into wrestling, which I will explain later. But Lou's like one of my closest friends, but he's also like one of my best opponents in the ring. And the way that the match was something that me and Lou both lobbied for a little bit, for it to be not just a match, but just like a street fight. Just to make it, you know, be a little bit different to what was on the rest of the card, which, from my memory, was a great card. You know, we had Big Strong Man against Paul Tracy in the main event, which was a fun match, but we wanted to do something a little bit different. And given that me and Lou have this shared passion for, like, 90s ECW and 80s Memphis wrestling, I feel like an Ayrshire Street Fight was, like, the perfect stipulation to have that match in. Obviously, there was a bit of nerves going in, just because, again, that was my first sort of like no rules match after COVID. I've done them a few before in Reckless, but this was the first one in a couple of years. And to this day, my match with Blue in Beef with that street fight for the UAWA Cruiserweight title is my favorite match that I have had so far. It was an absolute thrill. Not just because we had we basically had the audience like riled up for us. The feedback that we also got after the match, not only by the locker room but also the people in attendance, was that you guys had the best match of the night. It was special for me because it was also the first time that my brother-in-law and my three nephews saw me wrestle for the first time, and I actually ended up using my how old would it be now? My 7-year-old nephew at the time as one of the weapons in the match. I am really hoping that Respect still has the footage of said match, because again, I am very proud of what me and Lou did on that night. To this day, when people still ask what my favorite match was, the Ayrshire Street fight with Lou is number one, like hands down.
I mean, I suppose looking back, if you knew what you knew was coming after that, that would have been like kind of the perfect kind of closer for you, a match that, that would have been your favorite ever. It would have been against someone you've known for since they started, since you started training as well. It seemed like a nice cherry on top of a journey in wrestling. Now I don't need to pry too much, so you know you can tell me as little or as much as you want. So what was the reasons for you stepping away from wrestling?
Real life. So around about 2021, I kind of felt like I was kind of on a really good streak at the moment. Like I was coming back into wrestling. I was just starting a nutrition and fitness course in college because I started to like really get passionate about fitness and that side of it. So I wanted to like take that course and hopefully muster that energy to try and be like a PT, because also around that time I was helping my actual PT at the time with certain classes. Like basically he would give me workouts and I would like take them in person, and I felt like really good kind of helping people with that. And basically for like no various factors that I know of, around about 2021 and 2022 was obviously when the big cost of living like crisis happened. So, you know, the cost of living went up. You know, I basically found out like I couldn't really afford to do the course as it is. So I actually, unfortunately, had to drop out, you know, 6 weeks into it, which was kind of like a mental, you know, kicker. You know, I had to end up taking two jobs, one as a cleaner and then one as a restaurant worker for a 4-star hotel, which while I did enjoy, it wasn't really sort of like the two best jobs for me to do mentally, because I ended up going through like a big surge of burnout from late 2021 to early 2022. And I couldn't make training just because, you know, the shifts that they were giving me weren't lining up to like the times that training were for. I sort of missed training, couldn't really take any more bookings because I wasn't training enough. Kind of told the guys in wrestling at the time, like, look, I'm just burned out, like mentally burned out. Like I was struggling to enjoy certain stuff, and that included wrestling. And I kind of feel like I needed to take a little step back and just get my head in order to, you know, get back to where I was, not just in wrestling, but just outside of wrestling as well. You know, because I became like sort of like too much of a workaholic, where I just had to like work constantly, and I just didn't have any free time to myself anymore.
It's like trying to fill a void of something, you know. I understand that, and I think like definitely not in the same kind of boat. I was very lucky with the whole cost of living that I was sent home at the start of the pandemic, and that's just where I've stayed since. So I've moved rooms, but generally I've worked from home since, so I've been okay. But I had that kind of thing as well, not so much as a workaholic, but I was scheduling podcasts and recordings after recordings after recordings, because I needed to do something. And I kind of get that in a slight way. Your side's a bit more work than mine, a bit more hard to work, but I understand the burnout side of things. You said you lost passion for a few things. You said wrestling being one of them. Was it just being able to do it and appreciate it live, or was it just in general you couldn't watch it because you knew you couldn't do it? Was that a factor in there as well?
I mean, kind of like there were, like I usually tend to pride myself in knowing what's going on in wrestling, not just in Scottish wrestling, but just wrestling as a whole, like constantly, you know. I kind of feel like, see, if you're working in Scottish wrestling, then you should kind of know who works where, what the companies are, who the rosters are. You know, just to sort of get a good layout as to who your potential colleagues and, you know, opponents are. From like 2022 to like 2023, when I did come back, I just didn't really sort of follow it at all. And again, it was kind of a sense of, I was still trying to get my head together, like outside of wrestling, and, you know, try and muster up the fitness and energy that I had when we came back from COVID. And it just kind of was, I don't know, because like my last match didn't come off like my last match, and it kind of felt like I was leaving wrestling on a whimper and more like a bang. It just kind of felt like, not only did I let myself down, but I also kind of let my friends in wrestling down, because there was a part of me that was like, you know, you should be in there, you know. There's, you know, not only just for the people that, you know, care about this business, but you should also be doing it for the people that, shall we say, aren't really caring about this business and, you know, just trying to make a profit on their own back. Like, you should be in there showing them, like, how it's done and how to really, who, you know, how to give a damn about wrestling. But it wasn't really until, like, late 2022 where I found out I was going to be a father, and I started taking, you know, less time at work and more time to, you know, take care of my fiance during our pregnancy. That was when I started to start watching wrestling and enjoying it again, you know. And not only that, but like starting to talk about the wrestling the way I usually do, which like with so much, not to my own horn, but with so much knowledge and passion of, you know, somebody that cares. And even that point, you know, even my fiance started to see the difference of when I wouldn't really talk about wrestling that much to when I was talking about it properly again, like I usually do. So that was kind of when the the wheels start to turn, that maybe I should give this another chance. And I also kind of felt like there was a lot of stuff that I needed to still do when it comes to wrestling. And, you know, I didn't want to kind of leave wrestling unsatisfied, because, you know, it was something that not only did I need to prove to, you know, my friends and family, it was also something I needed to prove to myself. I'd probably say it was when I found out I was going to be a dad was when the difference started to happen.
It's when you find out, it kind of does something to your brain that just makes you just try to take it, just try to do something. Mainly, I think it's to make your child proud. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know why. I don't know how it just kind of just kicks in. But again, something that we can both we have in common was we both got a young child, so we both know that feeling of when it happens. You're like, right, I need to do something. I need to be passionate about something, because if I'm not passionate mm-hmm. about something, how am I going to show a young child that they could be passionate about something as well? And again, it's something I can sympathize with, something I can attest to as well. As soon as I found out, I was just like, right, I want to just make this podcast the best podcast I could possibly make it on a shoestring budget, and to just mm-hmm. balls to the wall, just getting guests and all that kind of stuff on. And it's something about it just resets the brain and just makes you just go, right, I'm gonna do the things that I want to do and work towards them. You mentioned
no.
Have I did disappear there? Did you disappear?
No, you're good. Just right. A little bit. That's all.
Cool. It's caught with the old, your internet connection's unstable. It's been a while since I've seen that message. That's always a terrifying mm-hmm. message to pop up. But so you mentioned Lou being intrinsic to you coming back. So what was the turning point? What was the moment where the conversation was made that, right, I want to re-enter the world of Scottish wrestling or professional wrestling again?
So it would have been the Copenhagen Championship Wrestling Show that took place in Lochwinnock in October 22, where they had the LKS Dojo of Excellence Battle Royal. And around this time, I was already off for about 8 to 10 months. I'd say like 10 months in full, but 8 months officially. So it was Lou that basically messaged me asking, do you want to give this another shot? You know, because I didn't reach out to him, he reached out to me, which I'm always going to forever appreciate for that man has done for me. So he basically reached out in October saying, hey, listen, we'd love to have you back. It's about Royal Spot for you if you're interested. Are you up for it? You want to come back to training? And at that time, like, heart says yes, but head was like, probably need to hold off in a little bit. My thought process was, I didn't think, like, one, I didn't feel like a couple of weeks of training and I was going to get ready for a battle royal. Not even just like in the sense of like physically as well, but also like cosmetically. Because while I left the jobs at the hotel and the clean post for about a year, I was working in a fast food restaurant, which was closer to home and, you know, far less hours. But again, it was just I also continued on when my son was born. It was just a diet of like fast food and caffeine, because again, it cost a lot. I couldn't really afford much else other than like free fast food. So I didn't feel like I was ready in that sense, but also I didn't want to jump head first back into wrestling while my partner was still expecting, because the last thing that I wanted was me and like, shall we say, doing a show in Edinburgh or Fife, where Mike's shows usually are, and I get the note that she's gone into labor and I'm not there. I didn't want that to happen, so I basically told Lou the full story. He was actually one of the first people that I spoke to about it before I made it public. I was going to be a dad, and he was completely understanding. He said, look, once you're ready, feel free to come back. So about, I want to say just like a week or two after my son was born, was when I went back to Lou's class. And, you know, I guess we'll talk about what's happened after that, but I've been there ever since. And, you know, if there's anything to take away from this podcast, is that Blue King Sharp helped me get back into wrestling. And because of how the last 18 months have been for me, I cannot thank him enough for that. It's, I'd say like the last 18 months of this sort of comeback I've been on, I've been more progressive and more rewarding than the last few years before I also took a hiatus. So, you know, I always appreciate him for that.
We'll definitely get into the rest of your journey. And unfortunately, when it comes to trying to note down matches that you've refereed and that, it's incredibly difficult. So we'll start. You'll keep me right with shows and what have you. I've got some bits and pieces noted here. But before I get back into that, we're going to reel back into being a dad, because I don't have a lot of dads on here, and especially someone who's a very new dad in comparison to myself. What was that first couple of months like when you realized, oh my God, I've got to look after a tiny human? That's a terrifying few months, isn't it?
I'd say a little bit, but for me, it was kind of ecstatic. Because for me, being a dad is by far the best thing I've ever done. I think it kind of helps that my son is quite a laid back little dude. Like he doesn't really tend to make a fuss. You know, he always sleeps through the night. All I just need to do is stick on Disney Junior or read him a book, and he's as chill as anything. But it does. And you'll probably agree with me on this, but like when you finally become a parent, that's sort of like a sense of maturity that you didn't feel like you're going to get. So kind of all the petty stuff that used to annoy you before you were a parent no longer matters anymore. Because you kind of feel like you need to show them not only how to be like a good role model, but also show them not to let the little stuff get to you. That's something that I kind of taken on the last year and a half with him, and finally it still feels a lot. He's still chilled out. You know, sometimes like me and my partner will take turns on who gets up early with him, because even though he does sleep during the night, he has a morning person, in the sense that by 6:30, he's like rattling his cot just to get out. So coffee does help a lot with that. But yeah, like, no, it's obviously going to be a bit more of a whirlwind when he gets older, but you know, I think much like any parent, I'm just going to enjoy the ride for what it is.
That's it. My boy was born 6 weeks early, so I was like, he's so laid back, but I'm sitting there going, oh my God, am I old enough? Am I old enough? Am I an adult in this situation trying to deal with it? And but less coffee. I'm not a coffee drinker, but my God, Monster got their share of purchases from me over the last 2 years, because it's been just, yeah, it's not so much he's difficult. He's not. He's amazing, but yeah, the fact that I've got to try and be the adult in the situation and go, I've got to show him everything. I've got like the anxiety that goes with it. It's just unbelievable. But I brought that up because during that time, during my first few months and that, I just ended up just watching wrestling because he was asleep, or I'd watch a movie in the morning or something like that, because he'd wake up at 5:00. And I thought, well, I'm not putting him back to sleep. I'm awake now. I'll go downstairs with him. I'll watch a movie. I'll watch some wrestling or that. Is there anything that you end up deep diving in, either whether it's wrestling wise or a series that you may never have gone into without him in your life?
I mean, me and my partner, like, we tend to binge watch shows on the regular, but I think thanks to those, like, sort of, like, late nights, early mornings, like, we end up, like, binge watching, like, the entire Grey's Anatomy on, like, two
Oh,
or three
wow.
months.
We tried.
Yeah, I mean, I'm surprised. And I enjoy it. Sorry, like, my partner thinks it's, like, one of the best shows ever, but when it comes to when it's been on the air for like 20 years, there was always like peaks and valleys when it comes to quality. So like the really good episodes are really good, but then sometimes they're just like almost like a slog to get to. But then again, unfortunately, I'm a completionist in the sense that if I watch a show and I get really invested, I'm going to need to watch like every little bit of it to see if it gets better. I think I'm one of the only people in Scottish wrestling that still watches The Simpsons regularly. I think that's on like season 34, and yeah, I think I've still watched every episode.
I mean that's hardcore as it is, but Grey's Anatomy. I got to I think season 16 is when we started tapping out of it, and we're just like no. But
Yeah.
oh, I remember my mine was, I was trying to go through all the Sony films, the Sony Marvel films, you know, our comic book films in general. So I watched your RIPDs and stuff like that, and I'll forever blame Alex Webb, but I end up watching Morbius, and on his, not on his recommendation, but he said
Of course.
I should watch it to say that I'll at least see it. And God, that was 90 minutes or whatever, how long it was. It felt longer. That I'll never get back, and I'll forever blame Alex Webb for that.
I'm gonna my review of Morbius is in six words. God bless Matt Smith. He's trying. Like Matt Smith was trying in that movie.
Matt Smith thought he was in an MCU film, that's why.
I think they unfortunately convinced him that he was in like the Tom Holland Spider-Mans, because they were like, hey, look here, we got Michael Keaton. It's definitely the same universe, so act like it is. Even though it's not, but it is. Look, Michael Keaton, go act your ass off, Doctor.
Oh, just terrible, terrible stuff. But anyway, back to positivity.
At least you didn't watch Madam Web, I'll say that much.
I have not watched Madam Web. No, that's I will leave that one somewhere, far away from me. So, you got the call from Lou. You got back to training, but you're part of the Looking Sharp Dojo of Excellence once again. When did you get the stripes? When was the call made for that?
I think it was about 2 weeks in. Mike was looking for a referee for a W3L gala. And because I already had experience refereeing, and then because I was at that stage where I was definitely going to wrestle again, but I didn't want to like rush into it. Or like rush cosmetically, or wasn't ready mentally. You know, I didn't want to like crap the bed, as it were. So kind of, you know, Lou asked, like, do you want to ref this Michael Gallon? I was like, absolutely, because I wanted to get back doing shows as quick as possible, but obviously wanted to also take my time just getting back to like properly wrestling on shows. So I think, I don't know where the location is, it bugs me, but I ended up refereeing a show that had Ray Barani versus Akiba Lee, Ruby Roberts versus Katie Mills, and then big massive tag match at the end where I think it was Mike, Sakib, and Ruby against the Tormentor, Ray Barani, and Katie Mills. So that was my first kind of show back, coming back, and it was a lot of fun, you know. Even the next few shows after that, getting to see people that I've not seen in a while. W3L shows or like VALOR shows, people were glad to see me. You know, they welcomed me back, like literally with open arms with some people, and kind of just made me feel like I never left, which was, you know, which was always, you know, nice to feel like, you know, within 2 weeks I went from like somebody just coming back to feeling like I'd never left. And so that was my first. That was my first show back, like 2 weeks in already.
And for someone who you mentioned yourself being a completionist, when you were told you were going to just we need you to referee the show, are you the kind of guy that then goes and goes into YouTube or network or whatever and trying to pick a referee in style, maybe try and pick up some bits and pieces from some of the like referees like Earl Hebner's, like Mike Kyoto's, Aubrey Edwards, whatever. You kind of guy that would do that, try and just not make yourself stand out, but at least give yourself a reason why you should be using myself for this shows, you know?
Yeah, because I kind of feel like there are a few companies that will kind of land in the bad habit of just having anybody be a referee, or like have one of the trainees be a referee, just so that they can, because they can't, when they don't have an official referee, or like to like kind of want to save money in a sense. Whereas when I'm asked to referee, I kind of also want to do the best job possible, because you know, I'm sure, and I'm not saying this, you know, out of pure bias, but I do think like referees are the most underappreciated part of a wrestling show. You know, we're not just there to like lay down the law for the matches, but we're also there almost like timekeepers, in the sense, just to make sure that the matches stick to their time limits, but also there to make sure that basically the wrestlers can go back to the locker room without any major harm. So yeah, I always take my job as refereeing quite seriously, and there's a lot like good, like great referees to watch on like the network and the AEW. There's also a lot of great ones to watch in New Japan. I'd also say like the independent scene as well. I know a lot of the AEW referees made their start on places like Ring of Honor, Beyond Wrestling. So you know, I'll try and watch them. I think even in the UK as well, we have like abundance of like great referees, especially down in England. So I'll tend to watch like a match like Steve Linsky's refereeing, or a match like Tom Scarborough's refereeing, and try to pick up little things that they do to keep them, basically just to keep them like invisible to the audience, unless they're really needed, which I always feels like sort of the best compliment that you can get as a referee is that, oh, we didn't even know you were there until we knew we needed you there.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, like those are sort of like main sort of ones I do tend to watch in preparation for any refereeing gigs that I have.
It's also a big ask 2 weeks back in, and I it might not be as physical as wrestling a 10-minute match or anything, but you're going to be there generally the whole show if you're older referee there. So you're going to have to try and keep track of every match, keep track of everything. I find speaking to referees that it's just as mentally challenging to be a referee as it is to be physically challenging, because not only have you got to make sure you're out the way, but then, like you're saying, everyone's got to stick to their times, everyone's got to be safe, everyone's got to be where they need to be in that moment kind of thing. And that sounds like a lot that's been thrust onto you after 2 weeks being back involved with it, when you're saying yourself that you were maybe struggling mentally and physically at the same time. So yeah, did you feel that you kind of you got yourself back to the fold like quite easily, like you kind of just went back into the wrestling mode quite easily?
I mean, mentally I was in a much better place after my, like during our pregnancy and then when my son was born, than I was beforehand. So thankfully I was like mentally back up to scratch. And again, with wrestling, sometimes you just kind of need to get thrown into the deep end and it's just sink or swim. Thankfully with those like first shows refereeing, I didn't feel like I had any rust towards that, because as soon as I did that gala day, you know, Mike gave me a few more dates for other galas that summer, and you know, end up doing two of his big shows that year, the Summer Spectacular and Resolution. Obviously did the CCW, the last few CCW shows before gaining Balor. And then at the start of the year, I started working for both Community Pro Wrestling and Attitude Pro Wrestling as a referee. So it was kind of like a really positive ripple effect that that sort of like first booking had on me, where, you know, I was thankfully like back on the scene, back on shows, and then back into getting, you know, consistent bookings, which obviously made more money, which is always a good thing. You know, sometimes you know, just you have to sometimes dive into the deep end.
Was the goal always
sink or swim?
Was the goal always to get back in the ring?
That breaks diamonds.
Like be a wrestler. It was that always say, or if you were asked to,
yeah, of course.
If you're no longer asked to be a wrestler and you're always getting referee bookings, would you have been happy with that, or was the goal always to be a wrestler once again?
I mean, there was a point where I was kind of happy just being a referee, because I was getting bookings. And, you know, I always say this, when people ask me, why do you referee? Why do you like wrestle? And why do you sometimes do like ring announcing and stuff like that? My mentality is if any one of the big companies ask you, or they want to have a look at you, it's always best to be as versatile as possible. So let's say, for example, if WWE or AEW say to me, we won't hire you as a wrestler, but we'll have you as a referee or a ring announcer, would you sign up? Absolutely, I would. Because I love wrestling, and I would love to make a full-time living on wrestling, regardless on what I do. And then it was around about the start of the year where I was getting back into shape. I got back into like really good shape over this summer, where sort of the itch started to come back, where when I came back initially, it was like, when I go back into the ring, then when I did a lot of like refereeing bookings, I'm like, you know, maybe if I'm happy here. And then it was the start of this year where it was like that itch started to get a bit more prevalent. So that was kind of when I started really dropping weight properly. I started to get you know, back on like a good balanced diet and like a good workout routine as well, because yeah, it was like I was gonna come back, and then I was like, no, I'm happy being a referee. And then I decided, like, at the start of the year, like, screw it, let's get one more shot.
So we'll get into your return in a little bit, but is there any matches in particular that you were just absolutely elated to be standing in the middle for? Because I saw a couple of ones where you came up for Community Pro and W3L, I think, as well. You did in Elgin.
Mm-hmm.
So there's loads of matches that you have refereed. So has there been any particular that you're just like, oh my god, I can't believe I'm standing here when this is happening?
Yeah, so I think probably my favorite matches that I have refereed, I'll give like a good sort of mixture from all the companies. On the Valor side, it was a blast doing the Texas Death Match between Glasgow Grindhouse and L&D at Red Dead Wrestling 1. It was just a mental main event. And then with it being our first time running the Opry, you can just feel like the electricity from the crowd when those four guys were going at it for like 15 or 20 minutes straight. It was just complete carnage. But yeah, absolutely, like one of my favorites. From the W3L side, the two that really stand out for me was from last year. It was Taylor Bryden versus Doug Williams from the Summer Spectacular, because that ended up being Doug Williams's last match for the time being. So it was kind of cool that, you know, I actually got to officiate like the last match of this like British wrestling legend, which is a nice little feather in the cap to have. And then you were there for this, but I think you both agree from the Summer Spectacular this year, Luke King Sharp versus Buffa.
Mm-hmm.
And the main event with that was a outstanding contest.
That whole show was incredible.
I would go as far to say that was probably the best W3L show in quite some time. Like, I think everybody just kind of knocked out the park on that one. I will say, like, my favorite match that I have done and I refereed that Attitude was Big Strong Man versus Magic Dave for the Hardcore title back in April, because I was, shall we say, sports entertained by the whole thing. And then on the CPW front, Sam Barber versus Joe Hendry for the CPW title a few months ago, just because it was kind of surreal, like refereeing Joe in between his like NXT stints. And it's also kind of cool as well in the sense that I've now, over like three different promotions, I've refereed Joe Hendry, ring announced for Joe Hendry, and then I'll say wrestle Joe Hendry, but I was technically squashed by Joe Hendry. Respect. That's a cool little trifecta there.
Bell count. I mean, cage match didn't say how long the matches were, so you know.
No, that's
you're
true.
In Joe Hendry, but that's wild. I mean, the thought that you can say that kind of thing and seeing his trajectory right now, it's just incredible to see that it's one of those ones where you can look at it and go, well, it's possible. You know, if you're passionate enough and you put in the work for it, then there is no upper limit to what you can achieve in wrestling, I suppose. And you get into being in the ring with these people and hoping that all these guys live up to your expectation of them and getting to meet them and all that kind of stuff. And I'm hoping that's also the case, that's also a positive that you can take out of these matches
just like everybody that I've refereed since I came back, it's just been completely sound. Like, you know, if you were to ask me, have you met any like buttholes in wrestling, I was like, I can't. Like, everybody that I've dealt with has been incredibly sound, supportive of each other. Which I know is a weird thing to say in Scottish wrestling.
I know. Like, oh God, I know, and I'm on the outside of it. So, David, speaking of Valor, I should ask. I need to do my due diligence here. Even though you were there, did you arrange the shooting of Jimmy the Ref?
You know, I personally still have no idea what's happening with the shooting of Jimmy the Ref. That case has kind of gone cold, really. I mean, I was at the bar when it happened, and you know, I was there with Stobe Malone, so I do have a witness to say, like, I personally, you know, I didn't shoot him. You know, Billy, I'm a father. I can't carry a gun. I need to show my son like good morals here. That plus, at the end of the day, like, see, if I were to shoot him, I probably would have missed it anyway. I'm not that great at shot. But no, I didn't arrange the shooting at all. I mean, I was already on shows with Jimmy when it happened, so you know, I had nothing to gain, unfortunately. Well, I'll say no. I've noticed that ever since Jimmy's kind of went missing in action, that referee Willie Moonbean's been taking a few more gigs, shall we say. So I think we've got another suspect there.
Or
he's you know, I know Willie's harmless, but it's always the quiet ones, okay?
So, or you're deflecting. Or you're deflecting. Stone Malone's your accomplice.
I would never deflect.
If
Stone was to shoot Jimmy, he'd probably just go in the ring and shoot him, you know. And Stone's that kind of guy, like, he just kind of wants the glory. He wants the glory for himself, you know what I mean? You know, he's got God's country to make proud, you know what I mean? They don't deal with any cowards that shoot people from afar.
Well, we'll leave that at the time being. It will be probably logged as evidence for whoever is on the case, if they still are on the case.
Yeah, we'll get Charlie.
Oh, of course, yes.
We'll get
course,
Charlie back. We'll get involved.
The assistant to the general manager, he'll get on it. We do have a question about your refereeing from Grapzilla, Mayhem Brooks.
Okay.
He asked, Why do you get angry when you hold when he holds the choke after the pass out?
Because I don't want him murdering the other opponents. Like, he's done it twice now. Actually, one on Brian Mojo and then one on the Wanderer. And I'm like, I need to let go because you've already I need him to let go because it's like you've already had him pass out. I'm not going to have you choke the actual life out of him. You know what? Imagine if he did it to Brian Mojo back at the last Attitude Show. You know, not only would Attitude have lost like their brightest prospect, but you know, like poor Mrs. Mojo, man. Like, how am I supposed to explain that? Oh, listen, I'm sorry about your son. You know, I know he only had to count of five, but I just let him anyway because, you know, there was nothing I could do. Like, you know, like I said earlier, man. You know, I need to make sure these wrestlers are safe at the end of the day. Can't have Mayhem Brooks, you know, go about murdering, you know, all the other talents. Now, mind you, no, given the recent attitude change that the Wanderer has had, I probably should have back in April, you know what I mean? Just kind of let it. Because that's when, you know, afterwards the Wanderer turned evil and, yeah.
Maybe that delay, probably, that yeah. delay you had, maybe just had an air pocket in his brain, which is actually just causing all this evil doings.
Yeah, oh God, yeah. Oh God, am I really to blame for the Wanderer's acts at the moment?
So you might not have shot Jimmy the ref, but you might be the blame for the Wanderer wandering away from his morals. The scoop here on the SWN podcast.
I might be the blame for the Wanderer. Oh dear, I am to blame for the Wanderer's mental battle against Ravy David. That's oh God, it's
keep you up at night.
Yeah. Oh God, what have I done?
Moving on.
I'm like stuck. Yeah. Oh dear, existential crisis. Yay.
Right, I'll leave you that. I'll leave you with that to just wake up in a cold sweat tonight about. But we'll move back into you become a wrestler again. So you
yeah sure.
So from the interweb, from the clips I've seen, you had a little bit of a scuffle with Big Buffa and other wrestlers on the mm-hmm. on the run up to it. They're starting to take liberties with good old Ref Sean, and they all came, well before that. Before that, you made your actual in-ring return to Unique Pro as part of the Big Strong Morans, with the Big Strong Man. So what was it like getting back into the swing of things at Greenock?
I'll give credit to Dave for this one. Obviously, Greenock's my hometown. I was scheduled to referee there, and then Davey asked me if I was like, oh, and I was like, hell yeah, like, first time my son's wrestling. First time I get wrestling. Yeah. I was like, hell yeah, absolutely. You know, I'm moving better, I'm feeling better. So I'm just like, yeah, let's go for it. And then even though me and Big Strong Man me and Big Strong Man versus TZ and then Wrestling the Big Strong Man, even though we were the pre-show, you know, we had what was essentially called in wrestling as a curtain sellout where pretty much all the guys backstage end up like creeping outside to watch the match. And that was a great buzz, man. Like, finally getting wrestling, Greenock Town Hall. In there with three guys that I highly respect, you know, for a company that I highly respect is, you know, and especially with my fiance and my son watching. It was a joy. It was an absolute joy. And, you know, I got the audience for the pre-show loved the match. A lot of the guys backstage loved it. What I find really cool, though, is like for the last 7 months when I was refereeing Community Pro, I essentially conditioned them that, even guys like Big Finn and Cassie and Brian Mojo and all the young guys and all that, don't actually know me as a wrestler before I came back. They all just thought I was just a referee and nothing else. So literally they're like, jaws dropped and like, wait, Sean can wrestle? Like, you shouldn't wrestle. You're a referee. And like, yeah, I mean, it's, you know, I've had a lot of experience before. Why didn't you say? I didn't ask. I think that was to do it. I actually managed to surprise the workers as well as the audience. I think that's a nice little achievement right now.
And that ultimately led a couple months later to being in the ring with Buffa. So it was a main event as well. You're the main event of the Valor / W3L Joined Forces show and Carl Luke, and you banished Buffa from UEWA and all UEWA affiliated promotions for a year. What was it like actually like getting involved with Buffa? Because Buffa is, well, you're speaking about passionate about wrestling. Buffa is one of those guys who's done it all and seen it all, and seen all the good and bad in wrestling. And I saw the clip of his single leg drop kick, and that must have been a nice wake up call to go, yep, I think I'm back in this now.
Yeah. Buffa's no joke, man. Buffa is a prospect of like Pro Wrestling 01, and every strike that he lays in, you can tell like he's from 01. That he is one of the hardest, probably the hardest hitter that I've been in the ring with recently. And well, even though he is an annoying nutcase with his conspiracy theories and all that, before he started his crap on Valor shows with me, you know, when he came back, he was a big sort of component in helping not only myself but everybody else in the dojo like move up a level. And that always happens every time like Buffa comes around. Like, he will impart knowledge to all the guys, because he wants to make wrestling better, and he wants to make us better so that we can make wrestling better. He is a credit not just to the dojo but to any school or company that will have him. I know also he was the reigning W3L champion all summer, but even at that point, like, Buffa, I feel, is a massively, and don't get me wrong, his attitude still sucks. And when the band's left, I'm pretty sure I will get his wrath and vengeance when, if and when he does show back up. But, you know, he is a very underappreciated talent. And while I managed to did get the victory on him, if you do look at the third, you know, it was by the skin of my teeth, because, you know, Buffa is one mean, tough son of a gun. And, you know, I know I'll probably have to deal with the ramifications of his banning next year, but, like I said, with his conspiracy nonsense, he was Icarus and he just flew too close to the sun. And, you know, I was the one that clipped his wings.
This is also historic for your own personal development as well, because hey, now you got the old shirt off. You were able to just let the body fly, so to speak. So for yourself, was that just that again a milestone that you needed to hit on your way back to wrestling again?
Yeah, I'd say so. Not like I had any choice in the matter, because Lou wanted to officiate the match, and he was like, "Give me your shirt. Don't have anything underneath. Give me your shirt." Like, okay, fine. And yeah, I was wanting my revenge of Buffa anyway, so it didn't really matter. So I was kind of, when I took off, there was a little bit of worry of like, oh, am I going to look fat in these photos, or am I going to look out of shape? And then thankfully, with the footage that Scott has put together, and then the photos that David has, you know, I feel comfortable. Like, obviously, no, I don't have chiseled abs just yet. I probably won't, but, you know, I look at that and I'm like, I feel comfortable. And, you know, thankfully, there's been no sort of like negative comments that I've had in my brain personally, where I've looked at myself thinking, oh, you're out of shape. I look comfortable. And that was a big personal milestone, because I've always ever wrestled in singlets, or because I was always just worried, not so much like my upper like chest, but even just like the stomach. I was just always just worried that I would just look, you know, flabby or, you know, toneless. But no, like even in the few photos that are there for it, you know, I could look at them comfortably and think, hey, you're causing that. There's still a bit to go. But then again, I always feel like fitness is always just like a never ending sort of journey. Like, you're never going to be 100, you're never going to be 100% satisfied. Because if you do, you're going to go back to resting on the walls and not progressing. But yeah, very happy. You know, if I ever do March, I might do 8x10s.
Do it. I'm pushing out to anyone who mentions merch, trading cards. Get you some trading cards. That's your money maker nowadays. That's your money maker nowadays, mm-hmm. in my opinion. So going forward then, October 6th, the Valor Red Dead Wrestling 2. You're on the pre-show against two. I mean, talk about throwing yourself into the deep end of things when you're coming back, because you'll be in a triple threat match, which, you know, that's quite a bit of pressure in itself. But you'll also be in the ring with mm-hmm. Luke Aldridge and Ozzie Michaels. Luke, of course, someone mm-hmm. who you would have had a lot of experience refereeing for, especially through W3L, mm-hmm. and Ozzy as well, a little bit through the Valor shows. And I've just caught myself in camera, and this room is absolutely roasting, and it looks like I've got like sweat wings on my glasses. So that's a tough one to go in for, because that's two guys, different styles. One hits hard, one just hits you. What's the thoughts at this moment going into that?
Well, even if you look at it, it's not even from ring race, so you just need to look at both of these guys' credentials here. On one hand, you've got Ozzie Michaels, who is a tremendous talent that we have at the LKS Dojo. Ozzie's like very dedicated in that he travels all the way from Carlisle up to Glasgow every single Monday, just so that he can learn from Lou and the best that he has to offer. And then even in that short tenure Ozzie has had, he's already shared the ring with guys like Ray Davey, like Seb Silvers, like Drew Marshall, worked for places like Attitude, Valor, and W3L. Now that's like, those are like three really good, strong companies to work with in a short period of time. Ozzie's just come back from just a little summer break where he's just kind of had to heal up there. And he has not lost a step at all. It is like he has never left. So you got that side. On the other side, you've got Luke Aldridge. Now, Luke's a guy that I have known for years. I've shared many locker rooms with him. I've never been in the ring with him. Even in my previous journey in wrestling, I never shared a ring with him. Luke is a very unsung pillar in Scottish wrestling. You know, he is a multiple-time heavyweight champion for W3L and SWE. He's been in the ring with legends like Doug Williams and Johnny Kent, and has taken him to the limit. I know that I am still relatively new in my comeback here, but between these two guys, and especially in a match like a three-way dance, where it's not just one fall, but two people in the match need to be eliminated. Yeah. Now, I kind of feel like I do still have a point to prove. I beaten Buffa, but again, Buffa's a tough man. Like, it was by the skin of my teeth. Not only do I feel like I kind of have to prove something in Valor, where I can still go and then But I also kind of feel like I need something to prove in Scottish wrestling. Before I took my little hiatus, I was always kind of seen as, I always considered myself to be a journeyman in wrestling. I was always just happy to kind of do as much as possible, have fun along the way, and that was that. Now that I am sort of a different person now than I was back then, you know, as a parent, as a soon-to-be husband, and someone that is on a comeback trail, I need to start showing Scottish wrestling that I can keep up with all the new blood that is coming through Scottish wrestling. No orders in the Asylum, in the Glasgow School of Wrestling, and in the Disco Academy. Like, I know, like, I've been around longer than some of these guys, but I'm not an experienced veteran coming in and saying, oh, I'm going to take you to school, kid. No, I'm a guy that's been around for a while, and I now need to prove that I can keep up, as a guy in my 30s, keep up with the guys that are in their late teens, early 20s, late 20s, and not only show that I can go, but that I deserve a rightful place in Scottish wrestling. And starting on October 6th, that is what I'm hoping to achieve from now, and then hopefully going into the next year, that's, you know, the best way to go forward is to, and I've said, you know, I'm following it through, but hashtag stand with Moran, because, you know, wrestling has helped me in so many ways in my personal life. Now it's time to for me to give it the effort that it truly deserves in order to get back on the pecking order when it comes to Scottish wrestling.
If I didn't have that many questions left to ask through the social medias, that would have been a lovely way to kind of wrap up the episode. But we'll dive back into the questions for a moment. So you had a little trip to Fair City Wrestling recently, and you have Patrick Patierski asking, after defeating Buffa, could we see a more permanent return to the ring for you? Sounds like that's the case, but I'll let you answer it yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but again, I'll also be officiating like Fair City Wrestling and VALOR going forward. You know, I'm looking to get back in the ring. I still have, like, obligations that I'm still willing to uphold. There's definitely people in Fair City Wrestling that I am looking to hopefully step in the ring with. Probably too many to mention at this point. Patrick will definitely be one of them. But yeah, hopefully, you know, come by 2025, you'll hopefully see me, hopefully, in an FCW ring, not just count the free.
Well, there's a Fair City Rumble coming up, so I don't know if that'll be a thing or not, but we'll see in the future. We do have a question from Lily. On you go.
I was going to say, I mean, we did have other senior official Chris Quinn enter many Rumbles in the past, so never say never.
Keep an eye on that. We'll keep an eye on it. We've got Lily asking, I'm going to reword her question a little bit, because she's put, who's your next opponent then? I'm going to reword it. You mentioned Fair City having a lot of guys that you kind of want to get in the ring with, Patrick being one of them. But going forward, who do you think you have to get in the ring with sooner rather than later to kind of just prove yourself, just for yourself, not just for your place in Scottish wrestling?
Well, it's kind of funny, like, despite being around for a while, you know, just by sheer luck, there's a lot of guys that I've been wanting to wrestle for years, and I've still got a good opportunity to wrestle. I would say Krieger is definitely up there. Krieger's a guy that I've seen go from strength to strength since day one for him. And now that he's the reigning W3L heavyweight champion, I feel that's definitely a mark that I need to prove. Speaking of other schools bringing out tremendous talent, we obviously got Power Pro, and, you know, Andy Roberts is definitely on that list. I would say, you know, any members of the NEK. I have wrestled, you know, faced Renfrew in the past at Reckless, but I've never wrestled him one-on-one. That's something that I need to prove, especially because he's now on a comeback trail. You know, when the time's right, you know, if Buff is ready and he wants his vengeance, I'm more than happy to give it to him. And then I still want my number one Scottish Dream match of being in the ring one on one with Grado. Because obviously Grado is still not a man in Scottish wrestling. And then it would also be like a full circle moment, because Grado was sort of the guy that, you know, helped me realize like people like us, so guys that will not be the most athletic, but obviously are, you know, the most hard, passionate, dedicated, and can have that great audience connection, is there's a place for guys like us in Scottish wrestling. And I would still love to have that match with him at any given moment. And then there's always just like a lot of guys that I now want to, I may have wrestled in the past and now want to wrestle again as a difference. Basically, me as sort of like a more, as a different person than I was back a few years ago. So hopefully get back in the ring with guys like Luke King Sharp, guys like Lewis Garvin, and even Fraser Garvin, I would love to get in the ring with. I think those guys are doing amazing work in ICW. I see a lot of bright talents coming through places like Glasgow School of Wrestling, Disco, and Garters. Like, I don't know. I'll probably have to do a Cody Rhodes and then write a list online of people that I want to wrestle. Because it's a long list. And this is something that I have learned. And it's something that I have made the mistake the last time that I did wrestle, where, well, I was perfectly happy just doing whatever. I was also really bad of just keeping my mouth shut and then just hoping things would happen. Whereas now I'm like, I want to make a conscious effort to let people know I want to wrestle A through Z. So I think after this podcast comes out, and then you might expect that list on my Instagram. We'll see what happens.
Manifest it. That's what I've learned as well, that you don't get guests on things like this if you don't at least try and manifest it.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just gonna clang. I didn't get Scotty Hottie by sitting on my hands. You know, that's all I'm saying. But I got Grado. Oh,
yeah.
I went for Scotty Hottie thinking that's the cool one. No, I got Grado. There you go. That was a lot of work, to be honest. But yeah. I got there. Anyway, enough about me. Back to you. We do have two questions that I'm going to finish up on from Fulton King. These nice, respectful questions. So you were dreading these questions, but everyone knows when it comes to this show, we try to focus on the positives, and so they behaved themselves. But Fulton King's got one. I think he's asking, he's just angling for a shout out. Favorite Scottish wrestler / tag team / up and comer?
Well, L&D are definitely up there. I'm not just saying this because they're two of my pals. Over the last year, those guys have been, again, kind of been thrown into the deep end with a lot of the opponents that they've been given. You know, as a tag team, like, they've had fantastic matches with guys like God Country and Casino Brutal over the year. Fulton himself especially had, I would say, one of the matches of the show at Backlash, when he held his own against BT Gunn. I would definitely put those two up there. While he's not relatively new, I think Stone Malone has gone strength to strength in the last few years, from being the Source champion to being part of God's Country. I think he's doing incredible work. Going back to Casino Brutal, they are one of my favorite acts to watch on any show. Because not only are they so entertaining, but their work ethic just now is unmatched. Just to give you a little example, the Friday before this recording, they opened up for CPW in Maryhill, and then drove all the way up to Perth just to main event with the Fair City.
Ash and Duke.
But there are, that was a fantastic main event as well. Like, Ash and Duke were on point as well. But that's the type of work ethic that you want to see in wrestlers, where it'll be like, we just did Glasgow, and now we're just going to do Paris, all in the space of an hour. And then just to, you know, I think also on the tag team point of view, I think Judas Gray, not Judas Gray, sorry. God, I'm gonna get shit on that. But, Ronan King and Judas Gray are doing brilliant at the moment. And then I think on the GSOW front, I'm going to just, you know, repeat what everybody says. I think Brian Mojo is definitely a guy to look out for in years to come. You know, he's already held his own with guys like LJ Cleary, and he's only like not even like 18 yet. It's just insane the level of talent that's coming through in Scotland at the moment. But, you know, again, you know, massive list. I can just go on for days about how great new talent in Scotland is. I will give a shout out to also Brody King. Well, not Brody King, sorry. Brody King, I will definitely give a shout out to. But also Brody Adler as well, you know. God bless Ari. You know?
All those names, absolutely. I can't disagree with any of them, and I wouldn't anyway, because it's your thoughts and opinions. I'm finally seeing Casino Brutale live and in living color at the end of the month at Fair City, so I am absolutely buzzing for it, because again, it's been an act that I've just thoroughly enjoyed as a fan for a number of a wee while now. So glad to actually get to see them wrestle, hopefully, touch wood and all that stuff, because there's still 10 days as we're recording this for that, between now and that show happening. So fingers crossed, I should be going down. Should be going down to Dundee for that. Fulton King is going to round off our questions here with, why is your top rope Rana so good?
I don't know, man. It's just, I've yet to break out. Yeah. I guess I'll let the audience decide for that, if and when I do.
It's one of those mythical moves that, you know, it's going to blow people's minds.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I know I'm, you know, just getting back in the swing of things, but I will say in the next couple of matches or shows that I do, let's just say I will have a few tricks up my sleeve.
Fantastic. So for now, I think we've caught up with the world of Sean Moran for the moment. There'll be you're just now back in the swing of things with getting back in the ring. You've got a match coming up, as we mentioned, at Red Dead Wrestling 2. So for people that need to know, go get a ticket for Valor. Just let's get all the plugs in. Let's get all the social plugs in. Where can people find out more about Sean Moran?
Yeah, sure. So you can follow me on my Instagram pages. There's obviously my wrestling page, which is Sean Moran Scott Wrest, where you can follow my wrestling journey. I also got my movie review page on Instagram called Screen Time with Sean, all lowercase. That's one that has been dormant for a couple of weeks, just because, again, Billy can understand, but you know, having a kid, you don't really have a lot of time to watch movies. Just a lot of Miss Rachel and Bluey.
Oh, yeah.
It's pretty class.
Oh, you have picked two absolutely stunning ones there. Nick Cope, throw a bit of Nick Cope in there. That'll, if you thought your kid was laid back, throw some Nick Cope in there, and that he'll just be horizontal. But anyway, carry on.
So that's my movie review page. You can also find me on Letterboxd as well. If you could just type in my name, Sean Moran, I will be there. You can find me on Facebook, which is still under my previous name of the rebrand Sean Moran Pro Wrestler. Wrestler spelled RASSLER. Because I don't know how to change it back, I'll probably still keep that name. If you just follow me on all of those, I no longer like use X as much as I usually like. But those are like the main four pages that I am on, so by all means give that a follow, especially my, you know, my Letterboxd and my movie page on Instagram, because I will be doing a lot more stuff, especially with Halloween going around. I'm going to be a lot more active on that. And then just go follow my wrestling pages just to document what shows I have coming up. Again, still going to be refereeing a few shows. I will be there at Adler Mania.
Yeah.
if it comes out, will be tomorrow, which is going to be a hell of a card. And then, yeah, I'll still be doing my refereeing duties at Valor, and then hopefully still, you know, getting the reps in the match end. So, you know, if there is ever an answer to the question, who's the hardest working guy at Valor, you're looking at him right here.
Fantastic. And before we do the before I properly wrap up, did you cry during the sign?
What sign?
The Bluey extended episode. The sign.
Oh God, yeah.
Sorry, have I just brought back some paint? Did you suppress it?
Oh yeah. Sorry, yeah. No. But being a dad has made me very emotional. Like,
oh God. Yeah, I mean I've never cried as much in the last 2 years than I have in any other time.
So it's not only that, but like, I'm going to sound like a complete sissy now, where I'm not saying, oh, wrestle with it, but here's where I've also cried that. So one of my son's favorite things to watch is Bear in the Big Blue House.
Oh God, no.
Yeah.
Oh.
Now, it's a bit emotional hearing the goodbye song, because that was something that, you know, kind of got me when I, you know, it's kind of like struck of childhood nostalgia.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you find out that the actress who played Luna passed away before the last episode, and then in the very last episode when they sing the goodbye song, like, Bear, like, kind of breaks up when he says, can we sing the goodbye song one more time?
I'm actually getting emotional. Like, you just
I know, I'm just it. Like... Why is Bear in the Big Blue House making me feel emotional? Oh God!
No, mine is the oh no, you well, finish yours. You finish your thought first.
Yeah, the other one as well is, like, I'm going back to watch some like more recent Simpsons episodes, and then see when the actress who played Mrs. Krabappel passed away. They had that lovely tribute where it's the chalkboard gag and it says, we'll really miss you, and their cake. I start tearing up at that. I'm like I've seen this before, but why is it getting to me now? Like, it's insane.
Mine is the Cat Stevens song, Father and Son. And I already cried at it during Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. And it came on the radio a couple of days ago, and I was driving my son to his grandparents, because he stays there every second Monday, and I was just greeting. I was just in floods while the song came on. Anyway, with that happy news, we're gonna stop the recording. We can share more things
that make
me cry. But thank you very much. Oh yeah,
thank you, man. I will say the other one that gets me is Mother Simpson from The Simpsons. The end of that,
yeah,
is just so sad and beautiful.
Let's go have a little cry together.
Yeah, that's fine.